Tonight's video begins with Juice of the Oats Oatmeal Stout from Oxus Brewing Company in Winnipeg. Described as an easy drinking dark ale with the aroma of coffee and chocolate. That creamy smooth body comes from the use of oats in the mash, hence it being an oatmeal stout. Today, I am looking at this little unit here, which is an ESD wrist strap tester. This particular one is way beyond its calibration and it's not working anymore, so it hit the garbage at work and I decided to recover it just to take a look at. And I'm not actually expecting that I can repair it, although who knows, I don't know exactly what's inside it. But basically, it consists of a power supply that plugs into the top, a couple of banana jacks down there to plug your wrist strap into, and a touch pad that you touch while wearing the wrist strap. And if your wrist strap tests good, the test good light comes on and a little beeper beeps inside. Now, ESD wrist straps are very common in industry. They're not as commonly used by like home PC builders and stuff. And I know what Linus Tech Tips and Electro Boom found in their testing, but regardless, it is a good idea, especially if you're working with, you know, multi-tens of thousands of dollars per circuit board equipment. It's a cheap little piece of insurance. That said, basically what this does is it connects to your bare skin and to a ground point that is both an actual electrical ground and a ground on the equipment. And it has in the wire one or more meg ohm resistor so that it dissipates any static electricity in you. It doesn't just short it straight to ground. And the reason you want that resistor in there is, I mean, yeah, if it was a straight wire to ground, it would definitely dissipate any static electricity you've got built up on you. But if you happen to come in contact with something that was live, then you've got a direct path to ground right through your body. Not a good idea. So that meg resistor in there or thereabouts, some of them are higher up to 10 megs, but 1 meg is sort of the minimum standard that most of them use. That will protect you and also protect the equipment. So this tester gets plugged in. Notice that it does also reference ground, and the negative on the DC voltage there is reference to the ground, or at least it should be. Yep, there we go. So that is ground. So you can test the wrist strap by either plugging it into one of those banana jacks or just connecting it to the normal bench ground, as long as the electrical ground is properly connected in your workshop. But for ease of use, I'm just going to be using the plugs on the top of there for my ground source. So with this fine piece of laboratory equipment plugged in, you can see that the power light is on and the test good light is not currently on. I connect my wrist strap up to the banana jack. Yeah, I know it's a clip lead. It is making a connection though. And I make good contact with my wrist strap and I touch there. I should be getting a test good light, but I'm not. And just to verify that I am in fact connected, there's that 1 meg resistance that we were looking for. That also proves that I've got a good connection here. The wrist strap is actually good. And you can test them that way. But this is intended to be just sort of a reference test on a workbench or in a lab environment or something like that. And as I mentioned, this one is well out of calibration. It should have been sent in a long time ago, but like so many places that don't require absolute traceability, our shop basically just kept using it until it stopped working. So let's just dig in and see what we can find inside here. Maybe there's something obvious wrong. Even if there isn't, it'd be interesting to see what makes it tick. As that is always the focus of these videos, for me anyway, is satisfying my curiosity. This is something that I've been staring at, you know, on the wall in the shop for years. So let's just see what's going on in here. I think I will have to unscrew those guys maybe. What's holding that board in? Ah, okay. So that wasn't supposed to come out that way. I suppose I could desolder the other one. Sure. There, that's the more civilized way to do it, I suppose. Right, what have we got in here? So we have power coming in here, polarity assurance diode, capacitor. What are you? 33 microfarad, 35 volt. Way overkill for that. Cool, cool. Handful of transistors, one little chip, a beeper, a switch, which turns the beeper on and off, depending on whether you want a quiet or noisy environment. This spring makes contact with the back of the test pad on the front there. And then just a handful of resistors. Huh. What are you, Mr. Chip? 2903D.
2903D seems to be a dual comparator, no matter who makes it, and no matter what prefixes, suffixes are on the number. So, just for the fun of it, we'll look at Fairchild's data sheet. 2 to 36 volt supply. Yeah, that fits. This thing's using a 6 volt supply. Well, current drain, basic, just dual comparator. Okay.
And then these two transistors, 2222A, 2222.
The venerable 2222, just a common NPN transistor. It's my go-to if I need a basic NPN transistor. They're cheap, they're commonly available, and it's an easy part number to remember.
This guy over here appears to be a 7805AC. 7805, I think, is just a regulator, isn't it?
78L05, 5-volt regulator. Yeah, that's what I figured it was. Available in multiple common shapes, including that one right there.
After some messing around and tracing things out and whatnot, which wasn't easy because this is a double-sided board. There's a handful of vias that are hiding underneath the resistors and a handful of traces that are underneath, you know, everything. Just like on all double-sided boards. But it's a fairly straightforward circuit if you ignore the power supply section, which itself is straightforward, and just whole bunches of resistors that are basically just holding things at known voltages. Here is what's essentially going on. We have a touch sensor up here going to one input of half of the comparator. The other half is going to a voltage divider, which is more than just two resistors, and it's got another capacitor in there just for stabilization. Ignore that. It's just a basic voltage divider going to the other side. So that's just comparing what's there and there. The output of that goes to the input of the second one, which is referenced to the 5 volts. So that is just acting as a buffer. Goes out through resistors to the base of the two transistors. One of them pulls the green light on. One of them pulls the buzzer on. The rest of it's just support components for all that. The power LED, of course, is coming off the regulator. The regulator is coming from the polarity diode. The polarity diode is coming, of course, from the power input and the smoothing capacitor on the regulator. A couple of resistors for stability. This switch can turn the buzzer on and off. It just goes right in there. Not a big deal. Surprisingly straightforward little thing, and I'm not sure why it's not working. I suppose I could desolder the transistors and test them. They're probably not the issue. If anything, I would guess it's probably the something wrong with the comparator. I don't have one of those. And besides, like I said, this thing is decades and decades old, and at home, I don't need a wrist strap tester. I can use my multimeter, just like I showed you before. So, that's what's inside. A Desco touch tester, laboratory equipment, wrist strap testing device.
In case you're wondering, this thing is still available, and it's a relatively common device. There's plenty of manufacturers that make them, but this particular one sells apparently for $124. With certification and traceability and all the rest of that good stuff. And it's even got a quick little manual. So it's expecting a wrist strap that passes the test to be somewhere between 750K and 10 meg. And of course, that is what my wrist strap really is. That's what it measures. And it shows you can either test to the device itself or you can test across a proper ground. There's some of the installation scenarios. They have it just in a workbench setting, and that's pretty reasonable. This grounded snap that you can use, or use the banana japs, either one of those. Yeah, and there's the little switch to turn that beeper on and off. Yeah, the circuitry inside the thing is not what you're paying the $100 and whatever it is dollars for. That is what you're paying for It's calibrated to traceable standards. And if you're doing lab grade work, you need that paperwork.
Just for the hell of it, I'm going to put this thing back together and see if it works. Maybe I bumped something. Maybe something was loose and my hack soldering here fixed it. I don't know. Yeah, I have nice continuity between those two and between the and to the circuit ground. So that ought to do it. Let's just see. Yeah, power weight still comes on. Cool. Okay. And I'm not expecting this to work, but what? That's what it's supposed to do. You can see the test good light comes on and the beeper beeps. And if I don't want the beeper to beep, then there, we still get the test good light. Oh, okay. Sure. I don't know what I did, but apparently I did something. Okay, well, yeah. Let's turn the beeper back on just for the fun of it and put the cover on and pretend I was never here. Well, that's an unexpected result. As I said right off the top, I wasn't expecting to be able to fix this thing. I'm wondering if maybe that spring that makes contact with the touchpad simply wasn't working properly, wasn't making a good contact or something. That would be the most obvious answer to why taking it apart and putting it back together would make it start working again. I don't know. But it clearly works. Well, thanks for watching. This satisfied my curiosity, and then it created more curiosity in me. Well, I hope you got something out of that. Comments and questions down below, as always. Thanks for watching. I'll talk to you later.